0200. It's Dr. Walsh and the other Dr. Walsh, and we are thinking about you guys and hoping you all are safe and well, and your families too. We're sitting here in our USC shirts. I've got my Spirit of Troy band shirt on. He's got his USC coaching
staff.
I'm part
of the coaching staff. Check it out.
He used to be the advisor for the surf team.
I was a surf coach.
And still is in his heart. Yeah. So anyway, this is our last lecture. It's week 14. You guys made it through a historic and very, very different semester. And we give you all lots of props for all the hard work that you've done this semester and everything that you've been able to do while you're at home. And you want to get into it? So he's going to control the mouse. We're going to go into the weekly assignments, and it's week 14. We're talking about elder abuse, and we're talking about another legal issue following up to last week. We're talking about power of attorney for financial purposes.
And just one thing, I'm going to do this slowly. So you guys should feel incredibly proud and look at your knowledge base. Look at who you've become. I mean, everything that we've been teaching about this entire semester is so applied to what's going on with your lives. I'm sure you've had lots of discussion with your parents, and you guys are now the go-to person. So I think it's awesome. Let's go into the final week.
Week 14, due next Monday, which is, I believe, the last week of class. Yeah. So we're going to talk about financial power of attorney, which is something really important. Last week, we talked about power of attorney for healthcare purposes. And for financial power of attorney, anytime you're over 18, if you have money in the bank, you should have a power of attorney that you've given someone to pay your bills in case something happens. So it's not as easy to get a form on the internet as it is for healthcare power of attorney. But typically you can go to your financial institution, whether it's the place where you have your stocks or your checking account or something like that. And they prefer people to use their form. So you fill out that power of attorney, and you're going to select a person that you trust to make financial decisions for you if you are not able to do it yourself. So that person is going to be your agent, just like a real estate agent. When you go to buy a house, you hire an agent that represents your interests. This is going to be an agent for your financial affairs. And these power of attorney forms can be very broad, and typically that's what we see. You're going to give your trusted person control that they can do anything on your behalf if necessary. But you can also just check a box that says, I only want this person to be able to pay my bills, or I only want this person to be able to sign for me in a real estate transaction, something like that. So you can make it limited, you can make it broad. Typically what I see is a durable power of attorney, which means once you sign it, that person can sign for you, which means you really need to trust them a lot because you don't want them taking all your money. You can also have a springing power of attorney that only goes into effect when you are incapacitated. So someone is going to have to determine that you're incapacitated. But either way, having a power of attorney is important once you're an adult, once you have assets, once you've got money in the bank. You've got to be able to have someone else pay your bills for you, take care of you if you are in the hospital, if you're sick, et cetera. But more commonly, this is going to happen with someone who's older. So it's a good idea to get this in place with your older relatives. And it's also a very good idea to monitor their accounts because you want to make sure that they are not being financially abused, which we're going to talk about in the elder abuse discussion. So appoint an agent. And I always like to have, as I say, as a lawyer, I like to have my primary agent. I like to have a secondary person who's a backup in case that first person can't serve, and maybe even a third person. So in my family, John's my primary. And then his brother, who I trust completely, is a secondary. And then my son, my oldest son, who's 24, would be my third person. Although my son, who's 18, is very responsible with money, so I would trust him too.
But there's a couple of her siblings.
They didn't make the cut.
They didn't make the cut.
We all have complicated family stories, don't we? So yeah, so you just want to make sure it's someone that you trust. And like I said, every banking institution is probably going to want their own document. Every state's going to have slightly different rules. So you want to make sure that your financial power of attorney is good in your state. If you spend time in two states, it's got to be good in both states, or you're going to have two. What happens if you want to cancel or revoke it? You tear it up, you sign a new one, you write down, you notify people that I revoked this, especially if it's for your bank. So there's a lot of ways that you can cancel or revoke it. And if someone asks you to be their agent, then you want to understand, okay, what are you asking me to do? What do you want me to do? And kind of learn about their situation and learn about their accounts.
No time like the present right now, since you're also at home with your parents, to really sit down and have these are really important, applied, kind of difficult conversations, but it's very, very helpful. So we had a scenario with I have an older brother who was very dependent on my mom. My mom passed and he was lost. And so we took over his financial responsibilities, and we are his agents. And this way because people were starting to cheat him. And so we inserted ourselves with his approval to make sure that everything would go right. And this is, especially as the world gets more complicated and your parents get older and your grandparents get older, they need you to be that person of authority.
Yeah. And so the story with his brother, who I adore, he's is just like my own brother, is that he's very innocent, very naive, very vulnerable to exploitation. He's had a couple situations where people did take advantage of him. He had a financial advisor that was taking advantage of him. His account that he had quite a bit of money in did not change in value for maybe 20 years. And this is when the stock market ran up and tripled. So I looked at a statement this morning, 1 year, the stock market had gone up 14% and his account remained flat. Now that's a problem. Something was going wrong there. We moved his account to Fidelity. I manage it for him. And, in the first couple of months, his account went up $40,000 or something like that. So,
and I'll show you last week, just to remind you, this is exactly what your discussion section was all about. So if we go to the previous week, when we were doing 13. This, it ended with, a daughter with, the same scenario. So is this not the week? I mean, it was the week before.
Yeah. Sorry. It's okay. It's fine.
I'll find it. I'm determined. It's okay. There's your critical thinking assignment. Now I'm going to get you all dizzy, I'll find it. Okay, that's all right. But it was, it was about a woman, and her mother had been taken advantage of by
2012.
Yeah, sorry. By a a money manager who was supposed to be the fiduciary, and
there
they weren't.
So she found out that someone was not doing the right thing. So that's why I think it is important to keep an eye on someone's account.
Absolutely, guys.
And make sure. And you don't necessarily want to have your name or you don't want to have that person put another person's name on the account, because then they can clear them out entirely and they really don't have much.
That was a really, really
much to say after that.
Let's go back to the discussion.
So that's a segue into our discussion this week, which is about elder abuse. And I did add some additional information this morning. So apologies for those of you that were really gung-ho and went into it already. USC is amazingly a center for study of elder abuse. And the dean of our medical school, Keck School of Medicine, Laura Mosqueda, is an internationally renowned expert on elder abuse. So we do have a lot of information here in gerontology and here at Keck School of Medicine. What's shocking about elder abuse is how common it is. And I think everyone likes to think, it's just an American issue. But what I'm seeing when I look at international data is that it is something that we're seeing across the world. So even though Americans are, I think, probably famous for not doing as much for their elders as they should, this is an international issue. It's a global issue. So we need to be thinking about it. So these statistics that I'm giving you at the first part are for the U.S. So 1 in 10 people reported emotional, physical, some sort of mistreatment or neglect in the past year. So that just doesn't mean 1 in 10 over time. That means 1 in 10 every year. And we see that financial abuse in the U.S. is the most common form of abuse, with neglect a close second. Now, this is going to cost people a lot of money. Billions of dollars are stolen from seniors every year. They are very vulnerable. What also makes it hard to go after the abusers is that most of them are family members. So there's a tremendous amount of shame and self-blame by the elder person who does not want to have criminal consequences attached to that the person that victimized them. So they're very reluctant to report their spouse, their child, their grandchild, their nephew, their niece, and say, hey, this person stole from me, or this person hit me, or this person did these things. So, and that explains the next graphic, which says 93% of elder abuse is never reported. And when it is reported, sometimes people think, oh, well, you have dementia, you don't know what you're talking about, et cetera. So that's a huge issue. So people who have dementia are at much higher risk of being abused. So 47% of patients with dementia in the survey were mistreated by their caregivers. And the caregivers kind of feel like, hey, no one's going to believe them. No one's going to listen to them. So we really, really, really need to focus on looking for indicators that someone is being abused and paying attention to that. Now, the consequences of elder abuse are very, very high. Someone who is self-neglecting is almost six times more likely to die within a year. Someone who is a confirmed victim of elder abuse is two times more likely to die. Even if it's just suspected elder abuse, 1.4 times more likely to die. So it has significant consequences. I've also added some World Health Organization information just to kind of explain to you the different types. We've got obviously physical abuse, which we see not just caregivers against the elderly person, but sometimes in nursing homes, we see patients physically combative with each other. So you can have all sorts of injuries that you want to look for. Does the person have bruises that are unusual? Do they have scratches? Are their glasses broken? Things like that. Psychological or emotional abuse is very common worldwide. It is the number one thing. In the US, financial abuse is still number one. So that's caregivers just being insulting, humiliating, confining and isolating the person. And that is a huge risk factor for elder abuse, isolation. Sexual abuse is less common, although it's certainly something that we're all afraid of. And we do see those cases in long-term care facilities where an employee who maybe has a criminal record associated with sexual abuse is sexually abusing patients. And sometimes it can be one patient versus another patient too. Again, financial exploitation is the number one thing that we're seeing in the U.S. right now, stealing someone's money, neglecting and abandoning someone. They're isolated. No one knows what's going on. Their family members or their caregivers just abandon them. And we've had some really tragic cases of that. And not to gross you out, but there was a case not too long ago where a caregiver abandoned the person that she was being paid to take care of. And they found the person mummified on a couch because the person just walked out and left her there and she died. So we have to be aware that oftentimes the abusers are family members, healthcare workers, people that are in a position of trust that we think, you know, I put my mom in this assisted living facility, she's safe, and then she's not safe. So the World Health Organization has done a study of risk factors. Thanks, Tom. And it's very important to think about why would someone be at higher risk? Think about it. If they are disabled, so they're not able to take care of themselves, if they are in poor health, if they have depression, if they have low income, low socioeconomic status. So those people are going to be physically isolated. You know, they're staying at home when the rest of us aren't staying at home. They don't have as much contact with the outside world. It's easier for someone to abuse those people. In terms of who the criminals are, the abusers, those people are depressed. They might have alcohol or drug abuse problems. They're probably financially and somehow emotionally dependent on the person that they are abusing. So it could be a nephew, grandson, whatever, living in the house with them that's supposed to be taking care of grandma and isn't. Another strong correlation is the two people live together alone with no one else in the house. So being isolated is a huge risk factor. So I also want to scroll down. I added this morning this information about elder abuse experts saying, you know, this is what's going on. So I thought it was interesting anecdotally to one of the doctors talks about the sense of shame is so severe for some people who are abused that they would rather commit suicide than report it. And I think that's true across cultures and across nationalities and across countries, that this is true for a lot of people. And one of the things on the bottom says social isolation is a huge risk factor. So I added some graphics about the dangers of loneliness and isolation. And here's a little tip. There will be a question on our final, our second midterm, not our final, about social isolation. As people age, the number of their social connections shrink. So, you know, you're in high school and college, you've got a big community, a big number of people. And as you get older, especially when you get over 65 or 75, and you start to be disabled and you can't leave the house, the number of connections you have with the world gets much, much smaller. Being socially isolated and lonely has the same health effect as smoking 15 cigarettes a day. It is a bigger factor for poor outcomes than being obese, smoking cigarettes, et cetera. It increases your risk of dementia. It increases your risk of depression. And, you know, all those factors, being over 80, having chronic health problems, not having close family, being low income, maybe having changing family structures really means, you know, your spouse passed away or something like that. And so they talk in this graphic about what you can do to help seniors, get them transportation, work to get them integrated into their communities. I saw a thing online where there was a little bench that says, if you want to talk to somebody, sit on this bench. This bench is the I'm available to chat bench. So old people could go sit on the bench, or young people could go sit on the bench and connect. Using technology, helping older people use these, they have like an iPad that's called like a grandpa pad or something that's easy to use. And of course, as we get older, we're techies, so we'll be able to Instagram everybody. Hopefully. So yeah. So the final prompt for the discussion is, have you seen elder abuse? Maybe you have, maybe you haven't, but what did you feel about it? And some people have some pretty shocking stories about their families. What steps do you think we should be taking to prevent and address elder abuse, especially taking into account the risk factors that we know about? People that are low income, people that are disabled, people that are, you know, over 80, people that are lonely and socially isolated. How can we combat that? And I've seen elder abuse in my own family. When my mom passed away, my stepdad was victimized by other members of the family. They literally descended upon the house and started taking things. And it was really tragic. And I think he was frightened and worried because he's disabled, you know, and can't really get around very well, that he was really scared about what was happening and what he could do to stop it. And
sadly, we were halfway across the country, and the perpetrator happened to live a half mile away.
Yeah, yeah. But I did send some angry emails for what it's worth. Yeah. So anyway, thanks everybody for hanging in there all semester. Thanks for all of your hard work. And I hope that you've got a good appreciation of gerontology, how important our elders are, and our responsibility as a country and as a world to try to make things better for our older family members in the future. And we're looking for you guys to really make a difference in the future.
And, you know, just, you know, engage your parents. And here's one way to do it. So this is the way we're going to end this. Okay. What I want you to notice is our son David is a mellophone player. This is all about the band. This is all about all the athletes. It's all about the cheerleaders. It's everybody. So it's also all about the internet.
Yeah, it seems like a long time ago that we were watching the band play.
Absolutely. Okay, here we go. Okay. Vanessa. There he is. This is my son, David. What does he do? Guys, we will see you shortly. And you guys are awesome.